Hello, and welcome again to all our practical and masterclass participants. We are now on part 8 of our tutorial series, focusing on the basic interpretation of musculoskeletal and spinal pain radiographs. Today, we will extend our discussion on the category of cartilage space. We've so far delved into various aspects of this category, including joint space narrowing, both symmetrical and asymmetrical, formation of marginal spurs, and marginal erosion. Next, our focus shifts to subchondral bone sclerosis. This phenomenon relates to an increased radiopacity found just beneath the cartilage layer, a subject discussed in part 4 of this series. If you missed part 4, revisit that section for better clarity. So, what exactly are we referring to when we mention the subchondral bone, and what does subchondral sclerosis imply? The subchondral bone includes two components, the subchondral cortical bone plate and the neighboring subchondral cancellous bone. Subchondral bone marrow sclerosis frequently develops due to stresses on the joint, including wear and tear or injuries. It's characteristic in conditions such as osteoarthritis, subchondral fractures, and avascular necrosis. Histologically, sclerosis of the subchondral bone marrow is characterized by increased bone density, typically resulting from an augmented formation of new bone, osteogenesis, seen in conditions like osteoarthritis and avascular necrosis. This creation of new bone is predominantly driven by cells known as osteoblasts, while the activity of osteoclasts, which break down bone tissue, may be diminished. When examined microscopic, sclerotic bone in osteoarthritis tends to exhibit densely packed, irregularly arranged lamellar bone, indicative of increased bone formation and remodeling. The bone marrow spaces often contract due to the excess bone tissue, and the bone marrow can present fibrosis and, in some cases, fatty changes. While osteoarthritis has traditionally been seen as a disorder primarily affecting articular cartilage, recent focus has expanded to include the subchondral bone's role. It is widely reported to have a crucial role in the pathogenesis of osteoarthritis. In osteoarthritis, there's often a relationship between alterations in the subchondral bone, subchondral sclerosis, and changes to the tide mark. Even though increased bone volume density might suggest stronger bone, various facets of subchondral bone quality and function are compromised in these conditions. Even though collagen synthesis increases in subchondral bone in osteoarthritis, the resultant collagen is hypomineralized and shows a reduced calcium to collagen ratio. Combined with the accelerated bone turnover in OA joints, these alterations decrease mineralization and reduced bone stiffness. Mechanical testing also reveals lower subchondral bone stiffness. Within the vertebral body, the subchondral end plate and the adjacent bone are equivalents to the axial skeleton subchondral bone. Changes in the subchondral bone can contribute to joint disorders such as osteoarthritis. In contrast, vertebral end plates and neighboring subchondral bone alterations can contribute to spinal disc disorders like degeneration. For instance, sclerosis or injury to the end plate can disrupt nutrient exchange with the intervertebral disc, leading to disc degeneration. Radiographic imaging may reveal a narrowing of the disc space and diffuse sclerosis of the end plates in the adjoining L4 and L5 vertebral bodies. These observations are often associated with the instability phase of degenerative disc disease, signifying the progression of the pathology. Subchondral sclerosis is also seen in avascular necrosis. In stage 2 of AVN, X-rays highlight areas of dense bone, signifying the onset of bone death or even collapse, depending on the stage. Similar subchondral sclerosis can be detected in cases of insufficiency fractures, similar to a compression fracture in the vertebral body. Depending on the stage, it can signify an acute compression fracture or a secondary reactive process. When evaluating the X-ray of the degenerative disease of the spine and peripheral joint, the relative flexibility principle and Kirkaldi-Willis degenerative cascade are a must-to-remember principle. Applying the relative flexibility principle is critical while evaluating the common attributes of joint degeneration, such as joint space narrowing, marginal spurs, and subchondral sclerosis. This principle asserts that our bodies prefer the path of least resistance when moving or completing a task. If one part of our body, like a joint, is restricted, another part compensates for the movement. Though this can be beneficial in the short term, over time, it can result in overuse injuries or other dysfunctions as compensating segments handle forces or demands beyond their typical functional range. For instance, in the case of spinal fusion or degeneration, if movement is limited in a certain segment of the lumbar spine, other segments may compensate by becoming more flexible. For example, if the L4-L5 segment has been fused or degenerated, the L3-L4 and L5-S1 segments may increase their mobility to allow for a continued range of motion. This adaptation can lead to heightened wear and tear on these segments, potentially instigating further degeneration or instability. Considering the connection between the hips and the lumbar spine, which work together during many movements like bending forward, if the hip joint doesn't allow for enough flexion due to tight hip extensors or hip joint dysfunction, the lumbar spine might have to flex more to achieve the same amount of forward bending. This compensation can result in additional stress on the lumbar spine and might lead to injuries or pain over time. In shoulder and scapular interaction, stiffness or restriction in the glenohumeral joint can affect scapular movement. For example, in conditions like adhesive capsulitis, there might be increased movement at the scapulothoracic joint to compensate. This could lead to overuse of the muscles controlling scapular movement, like the upper trapezius and levator scapulae, causing muscle strain, pain, and potentially exacerbating stiffness in the glenohumeral joint over time due to the successful compensation by the scapular movement. In each case, the relative flexibility principle highlights how the body adapts to limitations or restrictions, potentially increasing stress or damage to other body parts. This underscores the importance of addressing biomechanical restrictions and dysfunctions to prevent additional injuries or dysfunctions. Therefore, it's critical to identify the most flexible segments with instability and stiff segments with stabilization when interpreting a series of simple X-rays. There is another important key to applying the morphologic change to the pain, Kirkaldi-Willis degenerative cascade. Dr. Kirkaldi-Willis' influential work introduced a degenerative cascade, a three-stage process of spinal degeneration consisting of dysfunction, instability, and stabilization. This process was primarily drawn from his studies on the lumbar spine, but the principle also applies to other joints and parts of the musculoskeletal system. The first stage, dysfunction, is when the joint shows signs of impaired function. Despite minimal or absent pain, this stage can present with some limitations in joint mobility or a tendency towards hypermobility. When a joint or body segment, like the hip, becomes stiff or limited in motion, other areas, like the lumbar spine, may compensate by becoming more flexible, enabling overall motion to continue but increasing strain on the compensating segment. The timeline for this phase can range from decades to a more rapid progression, depending on individual factors. For a deeper understanding of various types of dysfunctions, their resulting functional impairments, and associated pain, I recommend you explore a specific book. This resource offers a comprehensive overview of abnormal functional alterations and provides strategies on how to evaluate and treat these conditions. Reading it will undoubtedly enhance your knowledge in this field. The instability phase makes the joint more prone to injury and overuse due to hypermobility. This condition can be identified through dynamic radiographic examinations, revealing which segments are moving excessively. Pain is often associated with this stage primarily due to unstable segments. Certain lifestyles or activities, like heavy physical labor or repetitive movements, might accelerate this process. In the stabilization phase, a previously unstable joint naturally evolves to a more stable state over time. This progression, however, could persistently cause discomfort and, in some instances, necessitate surgical intervention. Many individuals naturally adapt to this process by developing passive stabilizing structures like osteophytes, thickened ligaments, and an expanded joint surface area. Consider the lumbar spine as an example. The onset of conditions such as disc narrowing, marginal spurs, and ligament proliferation serves to increase the joint's contact surface area. This, in turn, restricts motion and minimizes both irritation and pain. However, the downside to this reduced mobility is the likelihood of triggering compensatory hypermobility in other segments, which can consequently lead to the emergence of fresh areas of instability and discomfort. To illustrate the three phases of progression and the relative flexibility principle, let's look at the hip joint as an example. In the dysfunction phase, decreased hip flexibility may be observed, leading an individual to depend more on the flexibility of the lumbar spine for compensation. This compensatory action, over time, could escalate into increased instability and pain in the lumbar spine, marking the transition to the instability phase. Eventually, in the stabilization phase, the lumbar spine might adapt to the formation of bone spurs, leading to reduced mobility. Although this might potentially alleviate pain, it simultaneously escalates the risk of hypermobility and discomfort in adjacent segments. In summary, the unstable lumbar segment might be stabilized with bone spur formation, leading to decreased mobility and potential pain relief in the painful segment, but increased risk for hypermobility and pain in adjacent segments if the patient continues to thrive to want the same range of motion or activity. So, sometimes it is clever to yield to the natural process of the degeneration of the joint and reduce the stretching exercise in the elder, but strengthening exercise is more important to facilitate stability and reduce the risk of the adjacent segmental disease. Repetitive actions in the wrist may trigger a state of dysfunction, causing some movements to become restricted or overly flexible. It can progress into a phase of instability, making the wrist more prone to injury. In response, the body eventually begins a stabilization process marked by increased bony growth and reduced mobility. Although this process can alleviate pain, it can also detrimentally affect the overall functionality of the hand and arm. However, suppose therapeutic efforts persistently aim to restore mobility, countering the body's natural stabilizing actions. In that case, the pain may resist such interventions or become intractable, leading to a situation where the treatment unintentionally contributes to the generation of pain. Understanding the stages of degeneration and the relative flexibility principle allows a clinician to derive significant information from simple X-ray imaging. This can help them identify potential areas of instability and compensatory mechanisms, enabling more accurate diagnoses and better management of patients' symptoms. Thank you for your time and attention. I look forward to seeing you in the upcoming videos.